It's funny that you bring that up. My son trains at Mo Vaughn Sports
Oh,
Academy
sweet.
down here in
Sweet.
Florida, and I had a chat, and I was chatting with Mo Vaughn, and he said, you know, this game nowadays, it really bothers me how this is so analytic. You know, you mess up these lineups. This team got you to the playoffs, and all of a sudden, just because you're facing this lefty pitcher, you change your whole lineup because of the analytics. When in reality, it's the team playing together as a group, feeding off one another, is what got you there and what got you over that hump. And that just goes to your point with, you know, we're fed all this information and we think that we have every single answer. And in sports, you got to go out there and play. You got to perform.
Totally. He's so right with that. And you're spot on with that too. I mean, I remember seeing the big man, number 42, Mo Vaughn. He had an excellent career. Man, could he hit the ball. Man. But your son's fortunate to have you and your wife, of course, and you guys raising him and being around
Got a
another
lot of meat behind it. He's got a lot of meat
long-time
behind
pro,
him, for sure.
Right? Exactly. Right? He's gonna be playing with power, whatever sport he chooses. But no, all that to say, he's exactly right. You guys are right where that's concerned, because the data that you're seeing, the stats, like, you know this, I'm sure you guys had the stat packs in the locker rooms before the game. You're in the locker room, you're in the dressing room, you're looking at the stats. Okay, what's this guy's completion percentage? What's this? What's that? How many times they run the ball? For us in hockey, all the same thing. We're reading the stats, stat pack before the game. And when it's all said and done, here's a great example of this too for the listeners. So you just mentioned St. Louis about 5 minutes ago, the Blues winning the Stanley Cup last year. Last year in mid-January, which we were about halfway through the NHL season, the St. Louis Blues were in dead last place in the NHL. Dead last. They changed the coach. My man Craig Berube comes behind the bench from assistant to head coach. The rest is history. He gets them off the mat from dead last in the league. And they go on to win the Stanley Cup last year.
That's
in seven.
The beauty of sports right there.
That's the beauty of sports, right?
Yeah.
That's the power of sports. So that's my thing where that's concerned. It's really interesting, man. But sports can literally change on a dime. Like, and you know, there's a lot of different things that I love and I'm into, from, you know, interiors to decorating to food to fashion to art to culture, all these different things. There's so many great things. Music. There's nothing like sports. In the world, there's nothing like sports.
We are talking to former NHL goaltender and NHL Network analyst Kevin Weeks. I have a two-part question for you.
Sure.
Are you surprised right now with Vancouver? And are you surprised with Dallas? And what are your thoughts for the Rangers winning the number one pick in this year's draft?
Okay, so as far as Vancouver, they're ahead of schedule. So would I be surprised that they're ahead of schedule? A little bit. But my good buddy there, Ryan Johnson, who I played with coming into the league with the Florida Panthers down in Miami, he's a part of their player development group. He runs their minor league team. He heads up their player development. They've had, in the last 3 years, including this year, 3 straight years with a Calder Trophy, which is the rookie of the year, with a Calder Trophy finalist in the last 3 straight years.
Wow. I didn't know
three.
That.
Three. And this year they have Quinn Hughes, who plays college hockey at Michigan, Wolverines. And, I mean, he's just transformed their whole team. So when I look at where they are, am I a little surprised? Sure. But they have all these young stars, soon to be superstars. They've drafted well. They've developed well. All those kids have become impact players. Their goalie, Jacob Markstrom, big Swedish guy, was an all-star this year. He couldn't play due to injury, but he was voted to the all-star game. So they've been really impressive for me. But what's really impressed me too, as a young team with all that skill, is those guys are playing hard and they're playing defensively too. And their head coach, who a lot of the listeners should know if they're from Long Island, is Travis Green, who played for the Islanders, played against Greening. And he's doing an awesome job. Young coach, holds them accountable, keeps a little bit old school, but then keeps it new school too in terms of his ability to relate with them and give them feedback. In terms of Dallas, I mean, Dallas, they've had the team. They just haven't been able to get over the hump yet. But I really think that what's helped them this year too is after the coaching change with Jim Montgomery, who had some challenges and was doing a really nice job as a young coach. Their assistant, Rick Bowness, comes in behind the bench. As I mentioned, he's been behind the bench for, I think, parts of five decades, if I'm not mistaken, behind an NHL bench. So he's been on the bench as a coach in some capacity more than any coach in league history. And what's cool about that, Nisi, you'd know this, sometimes it's good to have a coach that can get fiery from time to time. But if the coach is losing his mind over every play and every sequence, and he's on that roller coaster all the time, that's going to make your team very on edge. You know what I mean? If the coach lives and dies on every play, and if he shows that on every play, now you're, when you're playing D, you're playing defense, now your defense is tight. They don't want to make a mistake. When you go on offense, the offense is tight. They don't want to make a mistake. So all that to say, that calm that they have behind the bench from Rick Bonus, I think that's really helping their team, especially amidst a global pandemic, especially against everything that's happening with the racial inequality and social injustice. He just has a real smooth, calm personality about him. He's kind of Steve Kerr-ish. He's like a combo between Steve Kerr and Greg Popovich, I'd say.
And the Rangers.
I love that. And I don't mean to cut you off, Errol, but Kevin, you bring up a great point where, you know, I play for coaches that, you know, they go off on, you know, any mistake that's made and you end up playing tense. You know, you're scared to make a mistake. But, you know, when you have that even keel coach, when, you know, there's a lot of ebbs and flows in sports, there's a lot of ebbs and flows in life. If you can just stay even keel and go through, then, you know, you'll end up better off than when you started. But, Kev, I just on a personal note, man, I want to really thank you for coming on the show, man. You're really a person that I look up to. You're doing an amazing job with your post-playing days. You know, you're a great husband. And, you know, the way you carry yourself, please know that it is being noticed. And we all – you're setting the bar, man, and I appreciate what you do.
Oh, appreciate you, man. Back at you. I know how family-oriented you are. You never forget where you come from. You're getting after it. You're working. You're training. You're innovating in a lot of ways. You're also being open in a lot of ways, because that's one thing with players, especially since we're so accustomed to playing one role in our sport, or maybe multiple roles in that sport. From a playing standpoint, a lot of players can't expand their mind as much as they should, or use some of those same skills that you had when you were playing to apply those to a new career choice as we continue to mature and evolve. Yeah. Once the playing days are done, you've done an awesome job of that, business, everything. So appreciate you, man. Thanks so much for that.
Thank you.
It's, you know, as you can see too, a lot of it goes back to the way in which you're raised. And when you have a great support system around you, that helps. And then just making good choices along the way and being hungry. Like, life isn't over after you're finished playing. Mm-hmm. You know, for a lot of players, if you're lucky, you get to 30. If you're lucky and really good and fortunate, you get to 30. 32, I'm like, you think, whatever it is, 34. I mean, the odd outlier can hit 40 or 41 or 42. But for the most part, if you're in your early 30s to mid 30s, that's a long life ahead of you to live. So you want to continue to be successful in everything you do. At least that's really the athlete in me, as it is in you, as I can see. And you want to try to be as successful as you can, because you can only play for so long, and the new crop comes in. And you got to find a way to do something great, add value, make something better. And you're doing all that yourself. So thanks a million. Appreciate you.
Thank you.
Yeah, Kevin, man.
Kevin, before we let you go, because I know you have to go, I want to know your thoughts about the Rangers getting the number one pick. I know a lot of Ranger fans are so excited because they got the number one pick. What are your thoughts on moving forward for the New York Rangers?
Well, the Rangers this year were the same thing in the sense that they're so far ahead of schedule this year. I didn't think the Rangers would be where they are this year, or I didn't think they'd get there that quickly. But I got to tell you, them signing Artemi Panarin as an unrestricted free agent, and not just because my agent has him, Paul Theofanis, my agent out in New York, but not just because Theo has him. Panarin's a top five player in the league, and he's just taking that Ranger team to a whole new level. He might be the best free agent signing. No, he's, I say it on the air, he's the best free agent signing in Metro New York sports in the last 10 years.
Don't tell me that. I'm an Islander fan. Don't tell me that. Oh, my God. You know, I worked my hair in my head.
Straight up, he's the best free agent signing in all sports. Yankees, Nets, Mets, Red Bulls, Blue Bulls, I don't know, whoever. I'm telling you, he's been that nice with it. So all that to say, that changes everything for their team. Zibanejad has become a star here on Broadway too. They've got three goalies now. They're stacked at that position. But them getting the first overall pick, I think that would be massive for them. They just had the second overall pick last year. They took Kaapo Kakko, the young Finn, at number two. And for all intents and purposes, I think they'll take Alexis Lafreniere, the young kid out of Quebec this year. They'll take him at one. So they're fishing with dynamite right now. They're in a great spot. The Rangers are in a really good spot. They're going to have some cap challenges that they have to navigate because the salary cap will be flat these upcoming two seasons at $81.5 million for the ceiling of the cap. But they're in a good spot. The Rangers are on a nice track right now. They're ahead of schedule, too.
As you guys know, we were just talking to former NHL goaltender and NHL Network analyst Kevin Weeks. Kevin, thank you for joining us. Thank you for putting in the time, because I know you're very, very busy today as the NHL is about to start again after all the social injustice situation.
Thank you so much, man. Thank you guys for having me, both of you guys. EC, thanks a million. Appreciate you. And just want to say to all the listeners out there, I know a lot of you are sports fans in general, but I'm going to get into this for a little bit because I've been talking about it on the NHL Network. It's important to remember that every athlete or coach or administrator or person that's in the business of sports, for those of us that are and that have worn multiple hats, it all starts with us being people. The pads, the helmet, the bat, the skates, the gloves, the cleats, you know, whatever it is, the knee pads, all that stuff's amazing, but it all starts with us being people. That's really important.
Kevin, we really appreciate it, man. We really do.
Thank you.
It's crazy. You, I'm so happy that we're moving forward. And hopefully, with all this situation that's going on in the world, we can all come together and be one. I mean, you're seeing what's going on in the world right now with COVID-19. We should be together with everything that's going on.
Yeah, I mean, unquestionably so. Like, you know, one of the hard things is I'm fortunate in that I'm from Canada. My parents are from Barbados in the Caribbean. I've lived in the United States for 20 years. So I'm really lucky to hit that trifecta. But one of the things is that's really important is I'm hearing a lot of people and they're like, oh, this is political. That's this, this is that. From our standpoint or from anybody in the sports business and the majority of the good people that are there, you know, sports are a lot of what we do. They're not all of who we are. And there's no place called Athleteville or Sportsville that people live. There's only three bubbles going on right now. One in the NBA, or two, NBA, WNBA, and then our league, the NHL, has two. One in my hometown of Toronto, the other one out west in Edmonton. Those are the only bubble situations for sports. Aside from that, we're everyday functioning people in society. And just keep in mind that what's really important is when you look to a lot of the athletes and you look to a lot of us as Black people and people of color, in addition to people across all the spectrums, we're all interwoven in this multiple communities in which we live to an extent. Now, that might vary from place to place. Brooklyn might be different than the Bronx. The Bronx might be different than Staten Island, which might be different than Wisconsin, which might be different than Beverly Hills. But at the end of the day, man, you know, a lot of people are consuming the sports. They love the sports. But then they want to limit the support, or some people want to limit the support or people's ability and our ability to speak about injustices. And remember, when you go to that local hospital and you've got a young daughter, heaven forbid, and she goes into that pediatrician, if that pediatrician happens to be a Black pediatrician and your young daughter needs care, or they happen to be a Jewish pediatrician or an Asian American pediatrician or, you know, Latino pediatrician, are you going to say, my daughter feels real good right now. We'll just give her a couple childhood Advils and we'll pull her out of here. Mm-hmm. You're not going to do that. So it's really important to remember, man. I always say we're all here together. We all have some unique differences, which make us cool and make us cultured. But at the end of the day, the first name of this country, and I say the same thing for back home, even though it's called Canada, but the first name of this country is called United. It's United, not the divided states. It's the United States. And it's important that people keep that in mind and stay united. And thanks to all the people that have, and all the people that have shown us all the compassion and empathy that they have. And we just have to continue doing that and pushing forward and coming together.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you for joining. Well,
my pleasure, man. Well, my pleasure, guys. Thank you, guys. Bless, man. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely.